begin on page 355, page 355 of the Red Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Glory, glory, glory to God on the high. Gloria, 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 glory be to God on high. And on earth be peace to the people who God is well pleased. And on earth be peace to the people in whom God will is pleased.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to the disciples in the breaking of the bread, open the eyes of our faith, that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated for our Bible readings.
A reading from Acts. Peter addressed the people. You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us, as though our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now this, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 4 by whole verse responsively. Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I am hard pressed. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer.
Dear mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you worship dumb idols and run after false gods?
Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. When I call upon the Lord, he will hear me. Offer the appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord.
Many are saying, oh, that we might see better times. Lift your light upon continents, O Lord.
You have put gladness in my heart more than when grain and wine and oil increase.
I lie down in peace once I fall asleep. Earlier, Lord, may we dwell in safety.
Our second reading is from 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is where we are. The reasons the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever some may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear the voice of cheer, and just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You know how I know he lives in my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King. I hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find, none other than so loving, so good and kind. He lives, he lives.
The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord Christ. Jesus stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they were in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering. He said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to the understanding of the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And let us pray. Lord God, Jesus, resurrected life of the world, you live. Every time we gather here in this sacred space or gather in our homes in your name, you live. Every time we hear words of scripture, you live. Every time we gather here at this table, you live. Each time bread is broken in your name, you live. And every time we go forth proclaiming your love and your presence, you live. May that life always be within us all. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. I always think that the Holy Spirit works in all kinds of ways. You never know how or when it will come onto you. It doesn't have to be a miracle, like the parting of the Kansas River, or the Royals winning the series, or even a voice from the clouds. A miracle can be after the long, long, long winter. The green and colors of spring remind you of God's glorious creation. Or even a good morning from a friend or even from a stranger can remind us we're not alone. For me, the Spirit made an appearance last Sunday night after reading and beginning to reflect on today's scripture that I did most of this week, while I was watching a show on PBS called My Grandparents' War. It features well-known celebrities talking about family members and what they did during the Second World War, how they lived. I was struck in the episode I was watching when Helen Bonham Carter, who was looking at a picture of her family from that time during the war, and she said, "I have all these ancestors behind me, and they still say, you are the result of the love of thousands. Whenever you're lonely or really don't know what you're doing or lost your sense of direction, you just have to listen, for they are just a degree away, and they can show you the next step." At that moment, I began to remember my grandmother, who helped raise me in a significant way. She took me to church, taught me the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father, and planted the seed of faith. I remembered my Aunt Irene, who in 1960, her daughter, of just 18 years old, married a young black man, showing me what true love is and how brave a person can be when the whole world tells them they're doing the wrong thing. And then there's my dad's mother, who I never met because she died of polio before I was born. But at every family celebration, every holiday, stories about her bravery were told. Even that legendary story about her last day, when in her bed, She asked for the cross that was on her bedroom wall, took it, kissed it, and died. All these people I knew, and even the ones I didn't know, they were like ghosts. Not the kind of ghost that drifts around an English castle or the ghost of a scary movie. Their spirit gives my family meaning and identity, gives me meaning. I know who I am because of their life. When their stories are told, it seems like they're sitting right there at the dinner table with us, asking me to pass the mashed potatoes. They're real, they're alive, and they're always showing me the way to go. So I can understand why the disciples thought that Jesus was a ghost. They knew Jesus was dead and buried, but still there he was, appearing as if out of nowhere. They were lost. The disciples were grieving the death of a friend, the death of someone they dropped everything to follow, their teacher. But there he was, as if by magic, standing among them. The resurrection is more like a ghost story than it is a story of butterflies and bunnies. Fear and confusion is much more present in resurrection stories than happiness or joy. The disciples were scared. They were shut off, filled with questions, doubts. And Jesus takes away all their fears, all their doubts, all their questions with four little words. Peace be with you. Then he asks them to please pass them a piece of broiled fish. And it's like nothing changed. Once again, they're gathered around the table. Once again, they're sharing a meal with Jesus. Once again, they're sharing in the life Jesus gives. All through Holy Week and now through Easter, we're hearing the stories of Jesus' crucifixion, his resurrection in Mark and John, in Matthew, and now Luke. And it can get a little bit mixed together because each story has its own point of view. In Luke, this scene mirrors how the community worshiped. And it's very much the same way how you and I worship today. Luke told how the disciples met Jesus, encountered Jesus in their presence, just as you and I encounter Jesus in one another. Luke said how Jesus repeated the words of the prophets from the Old Testament, just as when we hear Scripture read, we meet Jesus. And the people of Luke's community shared bread and wine, just like we celebrate the Eucharist. Luke's community was sent out as witnesses to the world, just as like we know we're sent out, that church begins when we leave here to share God's love. It's good to remember that Luke is writing some 50, maybe 60 years after all these events have taken place, the resurrection, and he's contending with all kinds of questions about whether Jesus was really raised from the dead, or did the disciples just see a ghost? So Jesus proves that he's no ghost. First, by inviting the disciples to touch him, because we know you can't touch a ghost. And then by eating some fish, because we know ghosts don't eat. There's one thing we can say about Luke's resurrection scene, is that if you're a foodie like me, you should love this resurrection story. For Luke, the power and the glory of the resurrection is seen at a dinner table. For Luke, the power and the glory isn't seen in the cross like it's seen in Mark. It's not seen in Jesus breathing on the disciples, giving them the gift of the Holy Spirit like it is in John. It's not seen in Jesus giving this great commission to the disciples like it is at the end of Matthew's gospel. In Luke, the resurrection is real when Jesus is at dinner. He's human. After 3 days of being closed up in a tomb, he's hungry. Makes sense. Who wouldn't be? And he walks in, her friends are so frightened, they really don't know what's going on. They don't offer him a piece of fish to eat or some water to drink, a very common hospitality gesture that all of us do. So Jesus smells the food cooking, looks over the disciples' shoulders as they're kind of backing away in fear, and says, do I smell fish? Someone catches on and gets him a piece of fish, and they watch him eat. He's having leftovers. Spirituality and relationship are connected to eating. We all know this. It makes sense. It makes us human. We talk about being fed spiritually. And we're all looking forward to the day when we can again gather together with friends and eat together, especially looking forward to coffee hour. Eating is human. Relationships are human. Spirituality is a part of being human. And just like we can't exist without food, we can't exist, or our existence is deeply flawed if we lack relationships or we lack a spiritual connection. So for Luke's gospel, the glory of the resurrection is seen at the table. Today's reading occurs at the end of that very famous story about their walk to Emmaus, where Jesus appears in the breaking of the bread. And so now again, Jesus enjoys a piece of broiled fish and is revealed as the risen Christ. The promise of God, the resurrection, is right there, sitting with us, enjoying a meal. Jesus doesn't ask for a piece of fish to prove he's not Casper the friendly ghost. He chose that because he wants to empower the disciples to celebrate his love, share his love, his life around a table. Sharing a meal, Luke says, opens the disciples' minds. Not because a ghost is talking, but because Jesus was present with them, told stories of their ancestors to them, strengthened them to go out, proclaim the good news. I think we too are called by Jesus. We're definitely called by Jesus to be witnesses. And I guess for many of us, hearing that can be a little scary and difficult. We remember how often we can discount our own identities, our own powers. We remember how we deferred power to others. We remember how much we've determined that our witness may not make any difference at all, so why even try? Yet our witness is a crucial part. Our witness is a crucial part of our commitment and our calling. We are witnesses means that we embrace ourselves for all that God has given us, no matter what those gifts are, be they small or be they great. We embrace our faith in trust. We embrace our beliefs. And the hardest truth to hear for us, perhaps, is that we don't think or we don't believe in what God has given us. We don't believe God needs it. We don't believe others will see it. But our witness does not depend It doesn't depend on how ready we are or how confident we may be. We don't need to memorize the Bible. We don't need to have an answer to why we believe in the Trinity or why we baptize babies. Our witness is as simple as sitting at a table with friends, family, with neighbors, and telling them why you love coming here. Telling them about your friends here. Telling them about why you love the fact that we feed and care for so many people. Being a witness isn't about how much we believe or how well we believe it, but how much we love, how we welcome, how we gather at this table together knowing that we meet here the risen Lord. I think the primary temptation for people of faith, myself included, is to think that it's not our unbelief that we should worry about, but it's how we tend to have the habit to reduce, to describe and contain God's actions in ways that we can easily understand. Because if we can't understand God, then God is somehow something other, which means we can't control God. And we tend to fear things we can't control. It's all too natural a belief to think that God is way, way beyond us. And our task in our religious life is to improve ourselves and reach for God. Yet across the scriptures, across all the scriptures, especially in the New Testament, is that the story of our journey is not of self-improvement or become spiritually enlightened. The real story is about the holy God reaching toward us, to be like us, to encounter us where we are, no matter where that is. From the pains of Mary's childbirth and Jesus's messy birth in a dirty stable, to his disappointments and frustrations with the disciples, his grief of losing his friend Lazarus, his isolation in Gethsemane and death on the cross and despair, the picture of Jesus's ministry, his life, and his death is one that all of us can embrace. That tells us that God is embracing us. That God embraces us and accepts us as we are, not as we hope to be. Embraces us and loves us as we are. Redeems us as we are. We don't have to become perfect to reach redemption. So in Luke's story of the resurrection, God comes to have a real meal with real people and promises to resurrect real people. And so we come to this table fully aware that our ancestors have come before us. And thousands, the love of thousands, are responsible for us. So whenever we're lonely, or if we don't quite know what we're doing, or we've lost our sense of direction, or we're just tired of a year of this horrible pandemic, all we have to do is come. Come with open hands and find at this table the bread of life. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Turning to page 358, page 358 in our Book of Common Prayer, let us proclaim our faith. We believe prayers of the people are found on page 392 of the Book of Common Prayer, page 392.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work,
for our friends and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for this community, the nation, and the world. For the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For
those who are friendless and needy.
We pay especially for Lily Sanders for successful cancer treatment, for Debbie Murphy for healing, for Sherry for cancer treatment, for Jill for healing, for Marcia for healing, and for Rodney for healing. We pray for the peace and the unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For our presiding bishop, Catherine, for our priest, Tom, and for all bishops and other ministers,
for all who serve God and the church,
for the special needs and concerns of this congregation, and again, I will state Lily Sanders for successful cancer treatment, for Debbie Murphy for healing, for Sherry for cancer treatment, Jill healing, Marcia healing, and Rodney healing. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life.
Thanksgiving for this church.
We will exalt you, O God, our King.
Praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, remembering, especially today, John Lambalis, in memory of his passing away 2 years ago.
For Joe.
For Roger.
For Deacon Annie.
That they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them
who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. Peace. Please be seated. Well, good morning, church. Good to see all of you here. Where did this cold weather come from? This is not good.
Wait till Tuesday.
We're supposed to have snow, right? Or something like that? Crazy. Okay. Spring is still here, I promise. So just a couple announcements. Of course, this Thursday is our Center of Grace Day. Barbara, did you want to say anything extra about that? You can use the microphone if you want to.
No, I'll just stay here. I just want to thank everyone who has been helping us the last times.
I'm just thinking of the people watching. Sorry.
Okay. Yes, this Thursday is our opportunity to help serve the community, and we serve a meal at Center of Grace. I want to thank everyone who has helped in the past, certainly our cooks, Paul, and Bonnie has helped, and any of the rest of you who have come in to help me. Also, encourage anyone who would like to come. We start at 3 o'clock doing the cooking at Center of Grace, and I want to thank, if you cannot come then we really appreciate the desserts. Cookies or brownies that are wrapped up in individual or two or three in a package would be great. And those need to be delivered by noon on Thursday.
Yeah, noon or one is fine.
And Father Tom has been helping cook, too. I beg your pardon. Thank you very much. Also, just to know, we're still delivering boxes, so we aren't serving the meals yet. Hopefully, maybe this summer, we can start serving meals live. So, and Jane and Jim have been helping hand out those boxes every evening. If anyone else would like to help, that would be great.
They come at 5:15?
5:15.
Mm-hmm. 5:15 to hand out boxes?
Hand out.
Jim shows up at
4:45. No.
People start lining up at 4:45.
They start lining up. Yeah, it's amazing.
We do have to kind of stay there between 5:30 and 6:30. So thank you again.
All right. Thank you so much. And also just another announcement. I'm happy to announce, this is great, we do have some kids who just graduated high school or going to graduate high school or from this parish who are interested in going to Episcopal Youth Camp. So if you wish to help donate for their funds, it can be anything from $5 to $700. How about that? No, I'm not kidding. You can give what you feel called to give and just put on the memo line for EYC Camp. And that'd be much helpful. So hopefully... I've been talking to four people about going, about attending, and hopefully they'll get them going. I've been talking to Karen about that, so I'm really looking forward to, we can send four people to camp. Wouldn't that be amazing? And then those four could be the beginning, dare I say it out loud, of a youth group. I dare. But that's not why we sent them to camp. So don't get that idea if you're watching. We send you to camp so you can have a great experience with other kids your age, to find more about your faith, find more about Jesus, find more about our church. I think that's the most important part of camp, and to have lots of fun. It's a great time together. No pressure. Any other announcements? Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and offered himself a sacrifice unto God. Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his life we are risen again and won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. When we had fallen into sin, become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share in our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to be reconciled to us, the God and Father of all. He stretched out our arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering death, our Lord Jesus took bread. When he'd given thanks to you, broke it, gave it to disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he'd given thanks, he gave to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of our unending life in him. Sanctify also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy and peace. Into the joy and into the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, your Son, by him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
With those watching, we pray the prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the offer. I offer to offer you praise and thanksgiving as we proclaim your resurrection. We love you above all things and long for you in our soul. Since we cannot receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into our hearts. Cleanse and strengthen us with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let us not be separated from you. May we live in you and you in us in life and life to come. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. All are welcome to this table. Body of Christ, bread of heaven. Mark the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Take the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Carry the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Carry the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Carve the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Mark the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. In the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ, bread of heaven. Body of Christ, bread of heaven. Show the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. 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 Body of Christ, bread of heaven. Oh, body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ, bread of heaven. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ, 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 bread of heaven. Norma, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Mark, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Body of Christ, bread of heaven. Tom, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. Thank you.
and we, many, not the world. Or free, woman or man, or Lord, one bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth. We are one lucky in this one, Lord. Many the gifts, many the works, one in the Lord above all. One breath, one body, one Lord of all. One cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Pray for the fields, scattered and grown, woman or man of all, one bread, one body, one Lord of all, one of the blessing which we bless, and we the many throughout the earth. We are one Lord in this one, Lord.
Continuing on page 365. Page 365 of the Book of Common Prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and because of our spiritual food, the sacrament of his body and blood, grant us now in the world in peace, to grant us strength and courage, to love and serve you through our Lord's heart. Fed by word and bread at this table, may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Thanks to the risen Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give thanks to his name. For all your souls will go. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thanks to the risen Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give thanks to his name.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia. Alleluia.